Hi, I'm Eric Kelly from KellyPlanet.com. This is a closer look at Star Trek The Next Generation, Season 4, Episode 9, Final Mission.
I'm preparing to leave by shuttlecraft for Pentaurus 5, where I've been asked to mediate a dispute among the Salonite miners, unfortunately prone to violence. But first, I must deal with a situation of a far more personal nature.
So the captain is leaving the ship by shuttle by himself to go mediate stuff with violent people. That doesn't seem very safe. And we also find out that Wesley has been accepted to Starfleet Academy. Again, this happens once a season. So Wesley's going to go with Picard to deal with the angry miners, because I guess he's just happened to be studying outpost law, because of course he has. And Worf is getting a distress call.
An unidentified spacecraft has entered orbit above our planet. Radiation levels in our atmosphere have increased by 3,000%, but the ship will not answer our hails.
Of course, again, the Enterprise is the only ship in the area, so that's where Riker has to go. And Wesley and Picard are going to take that crappy shuttle sent by the miners because it needs to break down later. And that's the shuttle pilot Durgo, played by Nick Tate, who we will see later in Deep Space Nine. So they take off, and there goes the Enterprise.
I've lost navigation.
The port thruster quad's gone. Guidance coupling system severed. I can't stabilize her.
That sure didn't take very long. The mining planet they were supposed to go to is just too far away, even though it's right there. So they have to put down on one of its hot desert moons out by Victorville. That shuttle is totally junk. They can't even get a transponder signal out. And the replicator is broken, of course, and Durgo didn't pack any emergency supplies. So sucks to be them. Hey, there's the Enterprise and that radiation ship from earlier.
The vessel reads as an unmanned sublight freighter. Propulsion appears to employ a gaseous core fission reactor, but it is not functioning.
The radiation levels from that ship are off the scale.
Apparently this thing has been floating around for 300 years, and Geordi says, you know, yeah, it's a garbage scow. So Riker calls up that alien lady and says, hey, we found your problem. Are your people experiencing radiation sickness? And she says no, because this is a terrible B-story. Riker wants to send the barge thing into the sun, but Data says there's an asteroid belt in the way because ecliptic planes aren't a thing, I guess.
I don't like the idea of getting close enough to that barge to tow it. The radiation levels are so high, we'd be risking the contamination of the entire crew.
Do you have a better idea, Geordi?
We could send a construction module over to attach thrusters to it. Then we could direct it through the asteroid belt from a safe distance.
Worf gets a text from the mining colony about how Picard's shuttle hasn't arrived yet. Uh-oh. Riker says, well, we'll go look for Picard once we get rid of this radioactive thing. Wesley's got a tricorder working, and Durgo found some of Captain Kirk's phasers, and Picard lays out an arrow because he wants to head to those mountains, but Durgo's like, no.
You've got no right to make the decisions. I'm the captain of this ship.
If you want to get out of this, I suggest you listen to Captain Picard. He's the one who's going to keep us alive.
Thank you, Ensign. That's enough.
Do you feel that there is an alternative we're overlooking?
No.
Yeah, so that's that, and off they go. We got a bunch of these kind of shots, and I wonder if the lens is super dirty on purpose. Wesley says something annoying again, and Durgo sneaks a hit from his flask. Walk, walk, walk. Wesley's getting a low-frequency EM signal from those mountains and is getting stronger. It could be a life form, but they don't have much choice and continue on. Yeah, here we are, and at least they're out of the sun. Durgo's like, hey, caves mean water, but Picard says no. These were formed by volcanic activity, and then...
Patterns changed. The frequency's peaking a lot higher.
You have water!
I wouldn't hide water. That's called Dresky. It's from my planet.
Alcohol.
Yeah, alcohol does not help with dehydration. It actually makes it worse. And Picard points this out and says he's keeping it in case they need an antiseptic later, and now they go off to explore the cave. Bev is giving pointless medical orders for a thing that won't happen, and Troy stops by to tell her that Starfleet can't get a ship to look for Wesley for like a week. And normally that would freak Bev out, we'd have like a long talky-talk scene, but no, she's fine. Geordi bolted those thruster things onto the barge, and of course, that doesn't work.
Lost one module, correcting thrust vectors to compensate.
Structural integrity of the barge has been compromised. Disintegration is continuing.
Shut down thrusters. Worf, extend the shields around the ship. Lock on the tractor beam.
Aye, sir.
Okay, so the plan is to tow the barge with the Enterprise, which will put the crew at radiation risk and give Bev something to do. Now, ask me why they don't just photon torpedo that thing, or why they just can't fly around the asteroid belt. And oh, hey, there's a nice fountain in the middle of the cave. But there's a force field around it. Durgo tries to shoot it, but that doesn't work, and then a ghost appears and knocks some rocks loose.
Stop firing! Ah! Wesley!
Ah! That's not good. So Picard's right leg is broken, he's got fractures in his arm, and probably a concussion.
Just need to get my breath.
Will you tell him the truth? He's bleeding inside. He's never going to survive.
Mr. Durgo, I would appreciate it if you didn't bury me before I'm gone.
Picard tells Wesley he's not going to get better, and the ensign's going to have to get out of this on his own, which also includes dealing with Durgo, who has no idea what he's doing, and Wesley's like, okay.
First officer's log. Stardate 44307.6. Radiation levels on the Enterprise continue to rise. The ventilation system has started pumping hyronolin into our air supply to counteract the effects.
Data says the hyronolin stuff will only work for 38 more minutes, which is how long a Stargate stays open. And Bev orders everyone to the intersections of Decks 9 and 10, which is actually a really good idea. Data tells Riker that it'll take 51 minutes to get through the asteroid belt, and that math isn't so good, so they try to go faster, but that messes with the tractor beam, and now they have 35 minutes. We're back to the Indiana Jones portion of our Star Trek, and it looks like that ghost thing put Durgo's Kirk phaser in a cocoon.
Whatever we saw must act like a sentry to try to guard the fountain. If I can figure out how to manipulate the frequency, maybe I can control it. Now, the sentry first appeared when you used your phaser.
Durgo's plan is to use the phasers to lure the ghost away from the fountain so they can get to the water, but that plan sounds pretty bad, and Wesley says as much. But Durgo says, hey, your captain needs water, let's do this. So Wesley's like, okay, fine. So the ghost goes for Wesley's phaser, but it's pretty fast and wraps Durgo up in like a fiberglass resin too, so he's dead.
Mr. LaForge has diverted power from auxiliary fusion generators in an attempt to stabilize the tractor beam. This is the only hope of increasing our towing speed so we can clear the asteroid belt before radiation levels become fatal.
Everything is going good so far, but the computer says lethal radiation exposure is now 30 seconds. Ah, there's the asteroid belt that I guess doesn't follow the laws of physics, and now they only have 15 seconds. But they managed to get through it super fast because this is a very skinny asteroid belt, I guess, and they cut the barge loose just in time. The sun has gone down now and it's cold, so Wesley makes a phaser campfire.
Captain? Captain Picard? Sir, stay with me.
I'm trying.
Wesley brings up the time he and Picard took a shuttle to Starbase 515, which was a thing. And Wesley says he's done more in the last 3 years than most do in a lifetime. And he's right. And he's also saved the day more times than, like, all of the Avengers combined. Then Wesley tells unconscious Picard that everything he's done was to make him proud, and that's very nice.
If there is one thing that I've learned from you, it's that you don't quit. And I'm gonna think us out of this. You're not gonna die. I'm not gonna let you die.
The Enterprise is finally going to look for their captain and Bev's son, and Data points out there are moons around that can support life, and Worf says the miners haven't checked those yet, let's go there. We still have 8 minutes left in this show, so we'll spend 6 of them with these two. Picard wakes up and is like, yo, I need some water, but they don't have any, so that's what Wesley will be working on for the rest of this.
There's so much I wanted to tell you. The Academy. There's someone. Someone who meant a great deal to me. Someone you must get to know. His name is Boothby.
We actually get to see Boothby a few times between this show and Voyager. Wesley asks what Boothby teaches, and Picard says he's the groundskeeper, and he's one of the wisest men I've ever known.
Oh, I envy you, Wesley Crusher. You're just at the beginning of the adventure. Get the water, stay alive. They'll find you.
Oh, and Picard tells Wesley he's always been proud of him, because that's nice. I don't know how this works, but Wesley shoots the fountain to make the ghost appear, which should be fatal, but then he stops it somehow with his tricorder, and then the ghost goes through him, and is like, here, have all the water you want. Okay. Oh, here's Wesley's mom. He's okay, and they have Picard on a stretcher.
What are you doing in such a filthy uniform?
You don't look so ship-shape yourself, sir.
Wesley, you will be missed.
The whole point of this episode, and the only reason it exists, is to provide a decent send-off for Will Wheaton's character. Like Denise Crosby in Season 1, he actually requested to be written off the show, and we will only see Wesley a handful of times over the next 3.5 years, until Picard and Lower Decks. I understand where Will was coming from. When Roddenberry was healthy, Wesley was the focus of a lot of shows, which was kind of dumb since he was 14. Lately, the less biased writers haven't given him much to do because, again, he's a teenager. I don't know who told him this, but apparently Will Wheaton was also under the impression that his time on TNG could be better spent making the big bucks in feature films, which never really came to be. Hindsight, you know. This episode was a good send-off for the character, and the dramatic interaction between Wesley and Picard was pretty well done. Though, this is not one of my favorites. The radiation ship B-story was a whole bunch of bull, and asteroid belts are belts, not spherical obstacles. They even said it was a belt. Hence why us present humans can send out probes, you know, further than Mars. Berman and Piller love this episode, and so does Jerry Taylor because she wrote it. But as I mentioned, it only exists for one reason. I'm going to go 3 deltas out of 5. Let me know how you feel about that. If you liked that video, thank you. Maybe make a comment or subscribe if you want to. There's more Star Trek videos and other related content on my website. Check it out at erickelly.com. I'm Eric Kelly. Live long and prosper.